I would assume most men really care about testosterone and fertility. This short on testosterone has become pretty popular. It's a clip from this interview with Andrew Huberman on the Mark Bell's Power Project podcast.
If you're not getting enough fat, forget having decent testosterone. If you went on a low-fat diet, subcaloric low-fat diet is, you know, it's a form of nutritional castration, basically. Yep. Some people require more fat than others, but that is absolutely deadly to the reproductive system. If you increase your fat, in particular saturated fats, the vegan community is pretty angry with me right now because I said, sin of all sins, I said that I eat butter. I like grass-fed butter. Not, I don't eat chunks of it, I eat a little bit of it. And there's a video on the internet saying, you know, he's bad advice. My blood lipids are great, thank you. Dietary cholesterol is vital for hormone production. Some amount of saturated fat is good. If you put your saturated fat to zero, your testosterone will drop. Mm. There's no question about it.
I assume he's exaggerating there, but just in case he's not, who eats a zero saturated fat diet? Even a 2,000 calorie diet of just bananas has some amount of saturated fat, like 2.5 grams. Everybody eats some amount of saturated fat, even people on a low-fat diet, even vegans. Vegans can eat a lot of saturated fat if they want to. But really, he has two claims here. So first, he's saying that low-fat diets are bad for testosterone. They are nutritional castration.
If you went on a low-fat diet, it's a form of nutritional castration, basically. Yep.
That's a fantastic phrase. And then the second claim, saturated fat is good for reproductive health, good for testosterone levels.
Some amount of saturated fat is good. If you put your saturated fat to zero, your testosterone will drop.
Let's start with saturated fat. Is there any evidence on saturated fat and testosterone? There is. And at first glance, it seems to support Andrew's claim. This study found that both total and bound testosterone levels were higher for those eating a high-fat diet, with almost 4 times more saturated fat than the low-fat group. This one very similar, with the high-fat group eating more than double the amount of saturated fat. One of my favorite sources for nutrition and supplement information is examine.com. They're about as unbiased as you can get. No ads, no sponsorships, they don't sell supplements. Highly recommend them. Anyway, as they point out about these studies, the differences found are small, 10 to 15%. And more importantly, the low-fat groups, their testosterone levels are still within normal range. And the biologically active, the free testosterone, the testosterone that your body can actually use, was the same between groups. Probably why Examine makes no mention of saturated fat on their page about boosting testosterone. So it really does not make sense to eat saturated fat for testosterone, but if for some reason you think you need it, you don't have to harm animals to get it. The only things he mentioned, of course, is like butter and beef and egg.
For me, butter, red meat from good sources is wonderful. Eggs are really good.
Coconuts exist and they are full of saturated fat. So now on to Andrew's second claim that low fat is bad for reproductive health, for testosterone.
Absolutely deadly to the reproductive system.
It's important to note that the studies about saturated fat that I mentioned earlier, they weren't really on saturated fat and testosterone. They were on total fat intake and testosterone. So not only were the low-fat groups eating low saturated fat, they were eating low fat in general, very low fat, less than 15% in this study. On a 2,000 calorie diet, that's only 33 grams of fat. And luckily for us, there is a recent meta-analysis on this exact topic. They analyzed 6 studies total, 206 participants total, with low-fat intakes from 6.8% to 25%. 6.8, what is that, like 2 grams of fat? 15 grams on a 2,000 calorie diet. To give you some idea of what that looks like, one avocado has 21 grams. So yeah, kill me. They did find a positive correlation between fat and testosterone. The low-fat groups had lower levels, but there were several limitations. Lack of randomized controlled trials, only 6 studies, small sample size, again, 206 participants total. As per usual, more research is needed. You really cannot draw firm conclusions from this review. So to be so confident that a low-fat diet is absolutely deadly to testosterone levels, why? What about vegans specifically? You might have heard of this recent study that found normal testosterone levels for plant-based eaters, whether they ate a healthy plant-based diet or an unhealthy one. Another recent one had similar results, no difference between vegans and omnivores. There could be a couple reasons for this. First, again, fat intake. If we look at that second study, we can see that while the vegan men were eating significantly less saturated fat, as we would expect, overall fat intake was almost 30% of total calories, or about 64 grams of fat per day. So they were not eating a low-fat diet. They were not following recommendations from organizations like PCRM that promote 20 to 30 grams of fat per day.
In the course of a day, about 20 or 30 grams of fat, if you're reading labels or whatever, that's all you're going to need. You don't need more than that.
They were eating more than double the high end. Second, BMI. Multiple studies have found a negative correlation between obesity and testosterone. And when people lose weight, their testosterone levels rise quickly. Even a small reduction, a 5% reduction in weight, can significantly increase testosterone levels. As we know, and as the second study shows quite clearly, vegans tend to have healthy BMIs. Whatever the reason, the evidence clearly does not support this claim that saturated fat is needed for healthy testosterone levels and that vegans are therefore at risk for low testosterone. Even the link between total fat intake and testosterone is pretty weak. That's not to say fat is not important. You guys know me, I eat a whole lot of fat, and if I were a man, I definitely would not take PCRM's advice and eat 20 to 30 grams of fat per day.
About 20 or 30 grams of fat, you don't need more than that.
That was Dr. Neil Barnard. He's president of PCRM. He even says that we really only need 3% of total calories coming from fat. That would be 6.6 grams on a 2,000 calorie diet.
Maybe only maybe about 3% of your calories every day should come from those fats. That's it.
Which it might be true. I have no doubt that many people, if not most people, could survive on a very low-fat diet for a long time. But I don't think most of us are interested in just surviving, right, on the bare minimum. Higher fat is correlated with benefits that maybe don't impact longevity, but that we really care about. I would assume most men really care about testosterone and fertility. So going by the minimal evidence we have on fat intake and testosterone and the good amount of evidence we have on fat intake and heart disease, it just does not make sense for men to eat a low-fat diet, vegan or otherwise. Eating a decent amount of unsaturated fat, it may help men achieve and maintain healthy testosterone levels. And if it doesn't, these foods are still healthy and delicious. It's a win-win. Just for fun, let's look at fertility in general for both men and women. Saturated fat is linked over and over and over again to worse fertility. Now, does that mean saturated fat is bad for fertility? No, it's a correlation. Nutrition research is rife with confounders that are really hard to control for. The average person eating lots of saturated fat is also eating lots of refined carbs, minimal fruits and vegetables, is sedentary, is overweight. All of these are linked to decreased fertility. Perhaps someone eating lots of saturated fat, but also eating lots of fruits and vegetables, is fit, is active, maybe they wouldn't have an increased risk for fertility problems. It's possible. But the evidence definitely doesn't say saturated fat is good for fertility. What about veganism and fertility? There really isn't a lot of research on veganism specifically. There are a couple of sperm quality and motility studies. One found vegans had worse motility. The other found vegans had better motility and better quality overall. So not super helpful. And also the total number of vegans, both studies, only 15. So yeah, I don't think there's a lot we can learn from this other than vegans can have healthy sperm or unhealthy sperm. Shocking. But things that vegans tend to do, again, maintain a healthy weight, eat fruits and vegetables, limit mercury, right? We don't eat fish, seem to positively influence fertility in various ways. And the evidence definitely doesn't say veganism is bad for fertility. Back to testosterone. What if you're vegan and you have low testosterone levels or you're just worried about your testosterone levels? Well, besides saturated fat, Andrew also recommends a couple herbal supplements.
Now, for people that aren't getting prescribed TRT but want the increase in testosterone, there are these plant compounds like Tonga Ali and another one which is very interesting. It's a Nigerian shrub called Fadogia agrestis.
Unsurprisingly, there's very little evidence for these either. But there are a few things you can do. They're things that you really should be doing anyway. They're important for everyone beyond testosterone. Adequate sleep and physical activity, particularly resistance training, maintaining a healthy weight, adequate nutrition, particularly zinc, vitamin D, and magnesium. It's hard not to get enough magnesium on a vegan diet, but you can definitely be lacking in vitamin D and zinc. So make sure you have a source for those. Make sure you are eating legumes and other foods, pumpkin seeds that are high in zinc, and make sure you're taking a vitamin D supplement or getting some amount of sun. And of course, talk to your doctor. Who is Andrew Huberman? I wanted to put this at the end instead of starting the whole video with this guy's a quack. I wanted to just look at his claims on their own and see if they hold up, right? But it is interesting. He's a neuroscientist. He has actually done his research. I mean, literally, he's done his research, which makes this whole interview and other interviews he's done even more confusing to me. I mean, he knows better than to rely so much on anecdotes and his kind of clinical experience with athletes and testosterone. He should know that guidelines are not based on anecdotes or even clinical observation. That's what research is for, to see if there is really a connection between testosterone and saturated fat, for instance. Also confusing, he really emphasizes his own experience.
My blood lipids are great, thank you. And I'd be happy to share my blood lipid profiles and show I've done the experiment.
Who gives a shit, man? I mean, again, this is what research is for. One person's experience tells us one thing. It tells us about one person's experience. But since Dr. Huberman loves anecdotes so much, my partner, my husband, has been vegan for more than 15 years. We have three beautiful children together. Gosh, sometimes I want to plaster them all over my channel. 6-year-old, 3-year-old, and a 6-month-old. And we had no trouble conceiving. The first two took 1 month, and then 6-month-old, it was 4 months till I got pregnant. And there are lots of other vegan parents out there. So clearly not being vegan is nutritional castration and absolutely deadly for the reproductive system, right? Has this guy been interviewed by Joe Rogan? Like, you know he has. Oh, yep, he has. I shouldn't have called him a quack. He seems like a nice guy, and I like that he said he's not promoting lots of saturated fat.
I never said to consume butter in large amounts.
But it seems like he, again, is really interested in anecdotes, which is just weird, and seems to base recommendations off of that. He really seemingly wants to come off as an authority figure, which I get. He apparently is actually working with patients on improving their testosterone. But again, you don't make confident claims based on that. Recommending the supplements that have virtually no evidence for what he's claiming that they improve testosterone. It seems like he is very easily influenced by minimal data. So not a quack, but you know, just be careful, right? Just be careful listening to people. Always go for an outside source. Always check consensus, right? Harvard Health is really good. Again, examine.com. Thank you so much for watching, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that. I would love to know your thoughts on testosterone and veganism or fertility in general. I was really interested, and that's partly why this took me longer than it should have. I was reading a lot into the study that looked at a healthy plant-based diet and an unhealthy one. They were using this plant-based diet index from a different study that some researchers developed. And yeah, it's just very interesting. So I spent way too much time looking at that, and it really was not relevant to this, but that's what happens every time. Learning is too fun. I can't help it. Like the video if you liked it. Subscribe. You can hit the bell if you want to be notified every time I upload a new video. Thank you so much to my patrons at patreon.com/unnaturalvegan for supporting the channel. I do upload 2 exclusive videos there a month for $5 plus patrons. I've already uploaded the first one for January, and I will have the second one up soon, and it's going to be a little special. Well, my patrons know. Basically, one of the exclusive videos each month is going to be a controversial topic, something I would rather not post to the channel that's not really relevant to veganism. So, yeah, should be fun. And if you just want to give me like a one-time thing instead of committing to a monthly donation, right? You can. There's super thanks right here on the YouTube app. Anyway, thanks.